Today is day 10 of the intensive for me, and I can say I'm not the same person. I'm a better version of myself. I'm still similar, but a better version. It's kind of like software. It's, Word 6.2 or something, better than Word 5.8 or whatever. But it's a similar, it's a program's the same. I still have the same characteristics, but I can give you examples, really, of it's just amazing. Like, we have this gas stove, four burners, and the burner that we is in front, the front left, which is right near where we prepare stuff. So this is the one we always use, except it doesn't ignite. Does it click, the spark, click, 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 it doesn't ignite. And it's always been this way. So we've just, what you have to do is you have to, like, let the gas sort of build up and then blow on it. And then sometimes it, ignites it. And sometimes you have to try a couple times. Real pain. So it's been this way for decade or more. It's a long time since we had this stuff. And tonight, I'm in a constant flow of fixing stuff and making things better. It just somehow I suddenly have the ability to do this. You see, after 10 days of doing this, I am light practice. So I say, well, everything I touch seems to be fixed and made better. Let me see what I can do. I've tried to fix it many times with complete failure. So I just kind of took the parts apart, and then cleaned it and blew and kind of moved it around. So, okay. I mean, just, there's like nothing I haven't really thought of, I don't know. And then I turned it, it clicked, 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 ignited. Did it again, ignited. I said, oh my God, how's that possible? And I said, well, maybe it's a fluke. So I went back like a couple hours later, tried it, click, 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 poof, ignited again. I said, oh my God, fixed. We've been trying to fix that thing for 10 years with no difference whatsoever. I have no idea how I fixed it, actually, how it got fixed. So this is like been happening. The refrigerator is not sealing properly. It's been going on for quite some year or more. I don't know. It's been terrible. And sometimes you come in the morning and it didn't seal, and the stuff is not really cold, and it's like a pretty new refrigerator. It's a horrible thing that it's not working properly. And I said, you know what? That just isn't right, is it? And I said, maybe it's time just to fix it. And after about a minute or two, I got some pieces of plastic and taped it on, and just, boom, it works now. It works. No problem anymore. Fixed. I was like, what? So this is happening with all sorts of stuff. I mean, somehow I'm just like able to put stuff in order and it works. Whereas before, no. So it is for sure dramatic improvement, better version of myself. Dramatic. I keep thinking of stuff that I never thought of before. It's like I'm putting these water bottles in the back of the car, 5 gallon bottles of water in the back seat. I'm afraid they're going to tip over. I say, wait a minute. Let me just put the seat belts around them, one on each side, like passengers strap bottles in bike with seat belts, and they won't fall. Bingo. Put one in the front seat. Same thing. Strapped it in. No problem. I've never done that before. I say, it's a no brainer. Yeah. So all these things I'm doing, like, they're no brainers, but I never did them before. This is continuously happening. It's like, why didn't I think of that before? I was, obviously, this practice has raised me up, viewing things from the standpoint of the light more than the darkness. Now, it's really important to understand that the light is not here to attack the dark, to get rid of the darkness or anything. It's just saying, hey, I'm here. If you want to, it's kind of like a beautiful park. If you want to walk into the park's here for you. If you don't want to, that's fine. I'm not going to, like, go in there and destroy the ghetto, like, raise the buildings and put a beautiful park there. No, if you want a ghetto, that's fine. That's what you want. But here's this beautiful park. If you want to walk into it, it's there for you. It's like that. So the light is it doesn't attack. It's not trying to heal sickness. If you want to be sick, fine. But over here is this wonderful, beautiful light that can't be sick. You can, if you want that, it's here for you. So really interesting. It's just I'm like nonstop all day, just fixing stuff. I went back, the water faucet in the back has just been a mess for like 15 years or so. All this stuff on the ground, on the patio, there, and it's messy, and it just doesn't look good. And I just looked at it and I said, this is a disgrace. I don't know what to do, but I just feel like I can do something about it. I don't know. And then I found some stones from a stone wall that we're not using anymore. And I said, if I stack these stones, paver-like stones on top of our wall stones, on top of each other, and then stack them over here, then I can put a board on top of them over the faucet. And there's a shelf right there that can take everything off of the ground, put it up on the shelf, clean up the whole ground area, make it nice and beautiful now around the water, where the water is. Doom, done. Like that. Done. I was thinking I'd do it conventional way, but then I realized, my screw gun, the battery, doesn't last very long. It's an old battery. I won't be able to drive all the screws I need. Got to do a lot of carpentry work. And I said, no, just keep it simple and fast. Stack these stones up. We had some oak flooring left over that went together, tongue and groove went together. Beautiful shelf, looks great. Solid oak. And it's just done and it looks great. I mean, just did it like that. Did it like that. So maybe it's been bad for 15 years, just like an eyesore, just grungy. It's right by the dryer. The dryer gets it all grungy. It's just horrible. And in a matter of just like that, the whole thing looks beautiful and clean and has been elevated. It's just like, I keep doing this, keep doing it. Where's that coming from? Certainly hasn't been here before. And so the only attribution there possibly can be is doing this practice. I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. Thank you, Lotus family. I am light. Victory to the Lotus family. I am light. I am light. We got this. Transmission from the Lotus family, Amitabha Buddha, Padmasambhava, along with Longchenpa Buddha. All those three and the whole Lotus family are helping us out. And they've given us this, and they knew I would try it. See, that's why I was given it. People will say, well, what are you so special, blah, blah, blah. This is nothing special. It's just they knew I would try it out, give it a fair trial. That's why. And then I would report to other people that it works. So that's why I was given it out. I asked for help. They knew I would apply myself to this practice, and the difficulty of doing that is quite high. It's like, wow. The whole thing is a big wow. They knew I'd follow through on it, because I've been through so many psychological battles and difficulties and just innumerable. So this is another one that I'm going to see through. So gee, it's just like I said, I can make a golf scorecard and keep track of the days and stuff. Well, I just happened to be in the car today. And I was like starting to clean everything up. Wait, that's not right. That's not right. Why did I leave it this way? That stuff's old. Throw it out. Going through the cupboards, all this old food. Throw it out. Going through rearrange the entire kitchen today. It's beautiful. This is just like boom, 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 boom. Like half an hour. We've had the problem with potatoes and onions in the lower shelf that kind of rot. They're down below. You can't see them. And this has been going on for me 30 years. And I just suddenly said, wait a minute, I have these empty ceramic bowls, three of them. I just took them, just rearranging everything. I said, wait a minute, just put these there, put the onions in here, put the sweet potatoes here, and put the yams here. Boom, 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 boom. Done. It took me a minute to fix 30-year problem we've been having. that it just, we couldn't, nobody could figure out what to do. And it's just done just like that. And it works great. It's like, what? Yeah. Wow. I'm kind of like, okay, what's the next thing? So I was in the car cleaning everything up. This goes here, this goes here, this is all like this. And oh, that's what, oh, everything fits beautifully. And suddenly this golf scorecard was there. I thought I had lost it. There it was. So I have a golf scorecard that I'm going to now keep score about, during the daytime. How did I do with various situations? So I can get better and better and better at this, because it's still not good at it. I'm still not doing a good job at it, for sure. It's difficult. There's a lot of resistance, right? Habit is the resistance, familiarity, habit. I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. But I tell you, if you want to elevate your game, if you want to be a better version of yourself, does it radically change you? It's just that you seem to be functioning better. I mean, I've noticed all sorts of stuff that I'm doing better. In fact, everything I'm doing better, just about. Yeah, everything. It's like I have this car wash coupon or code from a couple months ago when I got stuck in the car wash, and they gave me a new one, but I didn't use it because I was afraid I might get stuck again. And so I've kept it for a couple months. I say, well, it's no good anymore. And I looked and I says, well, it expires November, 25th. I say, oh, maybe it's good. But I said, well, maybe it's not. I don't know. Never done this before. And so there's usually a big line to get in the car wash, and you get up to the machine to punch in the number. If you punch in the wrong number and it doesn't work, you're stuck in that line, and what are you going to do? You're in trouble. People get really angry at you. So I said, wow, I don't want to risk that. And then I said, well, maybe I can pay cash. I checked, I said, $10. I had two fives. I said, okay, great, that's enough. They said, wait a minute. No, they raised the price to 11. I said, ah, that's no good. Caught it. Then I said, okay, hey, go get pay for a new car wash, then go up there and use the old tag to see if it works. If it doesn't, you're covered because you got a new one. Problem solved. So I went up there, punched in the old code. It worked. Now I've got the new code I got today. I can use that later too. I can trust the expiry date will work. See, it's just like foresight and being able to see possible troubles and just clearly see what to do about it. Yeah, where's that coming from? Didn't have it before. Didn't have it before. It's just like a whole nother level of clarity that has occurred, actually. And it's just pragmatic stuff, really. I'm just sort of problem solving a lot better, a lot better. I mean, some of the stuff is just, it's amazing. That fixing that stove is, well, I can't even explain it, how it was fixed. It goes on and on and on, just being catching mistakes too, catching stuff before it becomes a problem. So this is why we were given this practice. I am light. I am light. It's going to raise our functionality up and up and up and up and up, and it has to be raised. It has to be raised. The world is just a mess. By design, it's trying to convince the prime creator that it should euthanize itself, because it's, things are never going to get better. They're so horrible. We're just pretending all of this, of course, but we're caught up in the pretense of it, and think if we stop pretending, we won't know how to function at all, and we'll be thrown into total chaos. That's called continuity fear. So we keep on doing it, and we are doing it. The world is getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. Wow. It's so obvious to me. Mamas and Papas song, California Dreamin'. Maybe one of the top songs in history, no question about it. I've been listening to it a few times to see if I can harmonize. Can't. It's very difficult. The charm of the song is that Mamas and Papas are two male voices, two female voices. So the male voice is, all the leaves are brown, like that. And then the female voices go, the leaves are brown, and the male voices, and the sky is gray, females, and the sky is gray. I've been out for a walk, out for a walk, on a winter's day, on a winter's day. Females comes in. Male, I'd be safe and warm, I'd safe and warm, if I was in LA, if I was in LA. Males, California dreaming, California dreaming, California dreaming, and then all four together on such a winter's day. And then Denny, the male voice, takes the lead. Walked into a church, dum, 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 dum. I passed along the way. I got down on my knees. God. Then the female voice came in. Got down on my knees, and I began to pray. I began to pray. You know the preacher likes the cold. He likes the cold. He knows I'm gonna stay. Knows I'm gonna stay. California dreaming. California dreaming. And all four. On such a winter's day. And then the flute comes in. Do, that amazing flute solo. That's how the song goes. It's back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And this I saw a cover on YouTube, and it's got three harmony singers, two women and one guy, and but it's got a female vocalist, lead vocalist, young, 20-ish, you know, young woman, female vocalist singing, and she did a pretty, you know, get a nice interpretation and did it in her style and stuff, kind of a raspy, kind of druggy voice, but it did, you know, the whole thing, the sound engineers did a great job. But where is the song? I mean, the song is the male, female, male, female, male, female, male, female, boom, all together like that. Bum, 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 boom. That's the charm in the song. That's the, and gone. No charm in the song. It's just this soloist soloing the whole way through with some, you know, background singers doing the, you know, the background harmony part. But I said, why did he do that? You know, everybody, all the comments, they're just like crazy. They said, this is better than the original. Unbelievable. It's so great. I said, what are you talking about? You know, these people are in a psychological state now where they've been conditioned to praise, you know, something unconditionally just because of the symbology of it, you know? It's a woman singing the song all the way through. It's fantastic. I've heard some other versions now as a woman just singing just that. And that's how it's done now. And they think that's it. That's wonderful. That's great. It's the best thing ever. It's never. I say, it's not even close to being as good as the original. It's not even touching it. The charm was that, the dynamic, right? That dynamic. It was so beautiful. The way they covered each other like that and harmonized with each other, the male and female voices like that. That was the charm of the song. And the flute solo is a great, 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 great song. But people are in a different state of mind now. An idolatrous sort of state of mind, a grandiose state of mind, as I've said over and over and over and over and over and over and over. It's going to goddess worshiping 100%. And this just shows it. Like they think like that it should be the female singing the entire song all the way through. And that how could it be any other way? It's got to be this way. It's like, but I know better. You see, I heard, you know, I was there when the original came out. I remember it very well. That song was just fantastic. I mean, it's one of the most iconic songs in history, without question. It started the whole California vibe, you know, in around the world. Like, man, wherever you are, you know, you could, if you wanted to be better, you could go to California. You could be in California, man. It's just this is like, it's our song. It's our song. You know, it's a Californian song, and we love that song. It catches just this mood. It is just so great, and it's just great the way it is. So, and I just noticed, you know, why are they doing this? Why are they doing this? Interesting. In the comments, I was stunned by the comments. I mean, it's not. What do you might say? It's not like a neutral listener, you know, it's biased. It's biased. It's very biased commenting. Really, really, really biased commenting. They're just like fawning and drooling over the whole thing, you know. And you know, I liked it. I said it's musically, it's nice. I thought she did a good job. I thought everything was a good, the sound engineers, everything was a good job. But it's just that nothing more than that. You know, it's just, but they're saying, oh, no. This is just, I got a list of this like 100 times. It's so amazing. It's so, whoo, there's something going on here. It's just, I mean, you could have 100 women singing that song and different, just as good, the way they did it with the background harmony and the sound engineers. You could plug in the thousands of women, whatever. But the mamas and the papas, nobody can cover it like they do, the sound of Mama Cass and Michelle Phillips, and Dettie and John Phillips, Dettie Doherty and John Phillips. It's just nothing sounds like it. So it's real interesting how people are very boosterish of this age. They're very boosterish of what's going on in the world right now. But those of us who've been around a while can see, compare. It's not as good. It's not as good. It's not even remotely as good as it used to be, actually. There is just, there is a major psycho pandemic in the world right now. And I was listening to another song two nights ago, Girls Gone Bad by Van Halen. Amazing intro by Eddie Van Halen. It was his anniversary of passing away a couple of days ago, I think on the 8th. It's just Eddie being Eddie. It's just like, wow. And the song Girls Gone Bad, well, that could be the title of this era that we're living in, is Girls Gone Bad for sure. They have been brought up, being idolized by Madison Avenue advertisers, politicians, school teachers, everybody, almost everybody, can do no wrong, and they're like, the greatest thing that's ever happened to the world type of thing. And so they have this extreme entitlement idea that everything they do, they've never been criticized, they've never been given just a, realistic, unbiased appraisal. And so they're just in a super entitlement, aggressive entitlement mood sort of thing. Scary. So that song, Girls Gone Bad, certainly that's going to happen. That is going to happen. So looking at the news about the Giants game, opening game against the Dodgers, and who showed up at the vice president and her husband with these shirts, love, 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 all these love on their shirts and their clothes. And it's like, I said, man, that just doesn't work. That just doesn't work with the, something is really amiss in this world. We know it's very amiss. So we're being helped by the Lotus family. I've been told directly by Longchenpa Buddha. Longchenpa's a Buddha. He's a full Buddha. And I've been working with him for almost 8 years now. And he told me it's going to be the worst time in history without question. From a spiritual standpoint, it is a disaster what's going on here. And so the Lotus family is helping us. And so it's not a surprise that Lotus family starts with Amitabha Buddha, the primal Buddha of the universe, so to speak. Then Buddha, then Padmasambhava, which is an emanation of Amitabha Buddha, to help out this world. And then Longchenpa Buddha, who's helping out Padmasambhava, and then many others in the Tibetan Buddhist pantheon of greatness, which is amazing. They're helping us out. They are helping us out. They know that these times are brutal, to say the least. So they gave us direct help. Padmasambhava gave us direct help and said, just do this, just. I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light. So, I mean, the world gone bad. Girls gone bad. When you get a super entitlement, arrogant entitlement complex, that's gone bad. That's the opposite of humility. We're supposed to confess attribution, error, continuity, fear, and false hope, habiting. This is a path of confession and humility and hard work on working on our mistakes. This is not an entitlement game we're playing here at all. Everything we get, we earn because we've been working on diligently on our continuity fear and regaining some confidence, giving little glimpses of the light, little glimpses of the light through real tough work, willingness to battle that continuity fear and take the dare to experience some of the light. Out of fear, you might become chaotic. It doesn't happen. And you gradually gain confidence that you can function without imagining limitations for yourself. And this begins to elevate us, the hard work. Real tough in the trenches with continuity fear is just the toughest work there is. We're not entitled, we're just simply, working to regain our confidence that we can function without imaginary limitations. We're going to what's intrinsic, not what entitled. Entitled is to say that you know, someone says, "Well, I don't have any continuity fear because I say so," and you're the ones who have it, and you're the ones with the problem. You know, no, we all have continuity fear here. We wouldn't even be here if we didn't have severe continuity fear, that and attribution error, continuity fear, and false self patterning. We wouldn't even be imagining that we're bodies, that we're flesh, that we're form. We wouldn't even remotely be imagining this. So the idea that, you know, humans can claim, "Oh, I'm a great human, I'm a better human," from this standpoint, from that standpoint, it's utter nonsense. It's utter nonsense. But when we start regaining confidence, we allow more light into our lives. We allow more light, and then we begin to be elevated. And I'm just practicing for 10 days. I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light. It has been a dramatic improvement. A dramatic improvement. I've never experienced such an improvement before, like in practicing. Never. This is by far and away, you know, the number one. And astonishing. It's so rapid. So rapid. It just showed up. Boom. Like, I was just like, "Hey, I can fix this. Hey, I can fix this. Hey, I can do this. Hey, I can do this. Hey, I can rearrange this. Hey, I can make this better. Hey, I can do this." And it's just like, "Huh?" And I'm kind of just like saying, "Really? You know, what's going on? Where's this brightness coming from in terms of solving, resolving stuff? Wow." It's just, I see it, and this needs to be done. Boom, do it. So I like this version. I really like this version. Better version. It's so again, if you want a better version of yourself, and you don't want to get swept away by entitlement, arrogance, and false hope habits, grandiosity, you know, all this stuff that the world is presenting to us right now, then elevating yourself into the best version of yourself is essential, is absolutely essential, absolutely essential. We can't stop. I mean, this, I don't want to pay too much, you know, any attention to the world, because it's so bad. When I see a little glimpse, I say, "Oh my God. Horrible." That they're not following the light. They're not letting the light into their lives. They're following cleverness. All the cleverness that we can manipulate the psyche and, you know, advertise in a certain way. And it's just, you know, it's the wokeness, is running amok like a cancer in the world, like a severe cancer. It should be viewed that way. It's a psychological cancer, what's going on. It's just, you know, inventing histories, claiming that, you know, everything was taken from you or some, you know, just guilt. They're into this trip that's just such a negative, dark, dark trip they're on. Such a dark trip they're on. That we simply have to put the pedal to the metal. Pedal to the floor, here two quads drink. Now the 413's lead is starting to shrink. He's hot with ram induction, but it's understood. I got a fuel-injected engine sitting under my hood. Tag it up, tag it up. Shut it up, buddy. Now I shut you down. We got to put the pedal to the floor. Put the pedal to the floor. Enhance engagement with the great spiritual, with the agencies of grace. Enhance engagement with the agencies of grace and get more light into our lives. Struggling with darkness is not the way. Get more light into your life. It's kind of like the difference. Let's say the room is dark room and you're trying to figure out a way to function and better in that dark room. Okay, that's not the answer. The answer is figure out a way to throw a light bulb on in that room. Speaking of that, there was a room here that had one light out and the other was dim. And I said, "The room's too dim." Went down to the store, bought, you know, three new bulbs, came back, and a second bulb went out. I put two new bulbs on there. Bam! The room just lit up bright. I'm getting lights and putting them in the right places so you can see. You know, just boom, 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 boom. Just, it's light loves light, you know? Light loves light. And so it's not saying, hey, we got to learn how to function better in darkness. No, it says we have the option to function in the light. We have the option to function as the light, in the light, as the light. I am light. We have that option. We have that option. I go into rooms and people are trying to read. There's no lights on in the room. There's like, I say, what are you doing? Turn on the light. Well, you know, yeah, I don't know. I say, what are you? Boom, boom. I turn the lights. Phew. It's so beautiful, right? And then you could see. You could see. And people are struggling in the darkness, trying to function in the darkness. Forget that. Just bring the light into your life by saying, I am light. I am light. Take it seriously. I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light. That's what I am. I literally am light. I literally am light. Wow. So just 10 days. Now, 10 days is a pretty good try. You know, if you can be pushing this as I have straight for 10 days, that's pretty darn good. That's right. That takes a real bit of, that takes a determination. Need to do a lot better, and I'll get work on that tomorrow. You know, it's now at this point, you just have to dig in and keep doing it. You know, the thrill, the opening thrill kind of thing is over, like a race, and now it's just got to steady, you know, settle in for a marathon and just keep trying to, you know, pick the game up more and more and more and more and more, and see just how far, how much we can be elevated with this. I'm just seeing, I mean, just like California Dream, I never could figure out how they sang that, how they did. I didn't know what they were doing. And I saw the video on YouTube, and then suddenly I looked at they were lip syncing it. I said, hey, wait a minute. It's just, it's the guys and the gals, and the guys and the gals, and they joined together. And I saw exactly what they were doing, and boom. I mean, that song's been like, yeah, how old is that song? It's like 55. I don't know when it came out, but it was 60, 65, 66, maybe something like that. So it's been, you know, 55 years or 56 years, something like that. And I could never figure out what exactly was going on. And I just suddenly just said, okay, I'm gonna look at this. Oh, I know what's going on. Just like that. Just like that. And I could do it. And I could sing that song with somebody. Get two guys, two girls. Let's go. Let's sing the song. All the leaves are brown, the leaves are brown, and the sky is gray, and the sky is gray. I've been out for a walk, on a winter's day, on a winter's day. I've been safe and warm, I safe and warm, if I was in L.A., if I was in L.A., California dreaming, born you. California dreaming on such a winter's day. Like that. Could do it. We could do it. We could do the song. We could do California dreaming song. Wow. People should do it. They should do it that way. They should do that that way. Don't have a guy just singing the entire song. Don't have a girl singing the entire song. No. It's just not, it's not done that way. It's not a good way to do it. We don't want domination. We don't want domination. The whole idea of that song is it's balance. There was a balance there. That didn't last long. By 1971, the balance was gone. Balance was gone. Then it started radical feminism. Started the whole thing, what's going on right now, wokeism, everything, female supremacy, goddess worshiping, all that stuff just took off in the starting in the 71, early 70s. Before that, though, there was a kind of a balance at that point in time. But we suspected it would go the way that it did, actually. Said, this is probably not going to last. And, of course, it didn't. It didn't at all. And now it's just full-blown madness in the world, really. Wow. So, you know, you can't expect that balance to come back, because it really was never actually there. It was a sort of like transitional time there. So it's for a little while it seemed balanced, but it was really transitional. This world never comes into balance. It's always transitional. It's always transitioning. There's no such thing as balance in this world, actually. So the thing to do is don't struggle with the darkness. Just elevate into the light. Elevate by experiencing the light and tell yourself, you know, you belong because I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light. That's what I am. I am light. That's what I am. I am light. That's what I am. You don't have to deal with darkness. Well, light doesn't need to deal with darkness, right? Wherever light is, there's no darkness. Wherever light is, there is no darkness. Darkness vanishes in the light, doesn't it? So just say, I am the light. That takes care of the darkness. We don't have to take care of the darkness by struggling with it. Just turn on the light, see, right? And then you can see, oh, I can see now. I can see how things, you know. So I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. So I haven't really been resting at all. It's like natural amphetamines or something, you know, really. I just feel in a groove where I feel like I can tackle stuff and get it right. And hard to explain. It's just the answers seem to just come to me. It just seemed to come to me. It just seems like, hey, you know, take care of this, 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 take care of this. I said, yeah. Just stuff that I could have done, you know, 30, 40 years ago or 10 years ago. Never did it. It's just a better vision going on. It's a psychological vision of everything going on. No question about it. I say, hey, I could do this. I could do this. It's kind of like, I tell you what, it's really like a rebirth. It's like a rebirth. It's like a resurrection from the dead, actually. It's a gentle resurrection. But compared to the way I was functioning before, it's kind of feels like I was dead before. You know? It's subtle. It's gentle and subtle, but it feels like a rebirth. It feels like I'm young again or something. A rebirth and a better version of myself. Resurrection from the dead, from struggling with the darkness of time belief, right? And instead stepping into the light, saying, I am light. I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. People are responding better to me. They're nicer. They seem to, like, you know, kind of like, I've noticed that also. They kind of like, you know, sort of like look at me a little bit like more than they used to. They don't just completely ignore me. This is like, so maybe there's like sort of a overall psychological brightness or vibe or something that, yeah, it's I sort of like, it's like the world has changed in a positive way for me. By elevating into the light. And anyone can do it. Anyone can do it. Just claim it for yourself. Say, I am light. It's just claiming it. Claim it. Claim it. Claim it. Padmasambhava told me, I am light. So he's claimed it. I am light. That's all he said. I am light. I said, wow. Wow, what a statement, huh? I am light. That's it. No qualifiers. No extraneous stuff. Just simple, direct to the point, I am light. And I said, wow, that really floored me. I was like, just whew. Profound, profound, profound. And then I say, hey, he wants me to say it too. Say, I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light. That's all we need to say. I am light. We don't need to go on some complex effusiveness in any direction. Just stay just with this. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. I redid the entire refrigerator, threw all this stuff out, got garbage cans full of stuff. I threw so much stuff out, old stuff, the stuff we hadn't stuff that hadn't been touched in 30 years, in the cupboards, 20 years. The refrigerator, all this stuff is just like, what the heck is that? You know, get it out of there. Reformatted the fridge, put stuff in snap transparent containers so you can see the food there, you know, and just figured it out way better than before. This section is for this. This section is for this. This is up there. That's for there. And I was able to just organize it better. You know, organize it better. The organizing ability has improved. How does that happen at 65, you know, where I'm hardly sleeping at all, you know, got long haulers, all this stuff against me, all sorts of crises. I'm taking care of people who've been injured, and just so much stuff is on my shoulders. And yet, Somehow my organizational ability and ability do this and just is way better than it. It's getting better and better and better every day. How does that happen? You see, how does that happen? Well, we have a causation of it. Okay, very strong causation of it, because it wasn't there before I started this practice. It wasn't there very much. Maybe it was kind of like gestationing, you know, by saying, you know, just giving blanket praise for the act of dreaming. Wow, just blanket praise for the act of dreaming. Wow, that started, kind of started things, primed it. But then I am light. That the fire has taken off. The fire has taken off. It's like the fire is burning. The fire is burning now. Is able to kindle the fire, get it started with that, just praising the act of dreaming. Wow, just universal blanket praising for the act of dreaming. Wow, that's really helpful. That gets the tinder going. But now, whew, the wind comes and the tinder ignites the wood that's on top of it. And now the fire, you know, it's burning and it's giving light. It's giving light. You're starting to be able to see better. It's just everything seems a little sharper in terms of recognizing what's going on. Smarter, more capable, moving faster, more coordinated, sort of anticipating things better, and not forgetting or catching mistakes quicker, so things don't you know, get out of hand. And there's room for improvement. There's a lot of room for improvement too. And so in today's world, you know, we have to have this capacity, very stable, elevated capacity right now. Otherwise, you're just gonna get hammered, just hammered, 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 hammered. I cleaned out the water heater space with all this junky stuff there, dangerous. Clean that out today too. You know, just all the stuff in one day. So many things that have been bad for like 30 years. I did it all in one day. Fixed it all in one day. Yeah, that just doesn't happen unless something has changed. Something has changed. The only thing that's changed in my life is to say, I am light. That's it. But everything else is the same. I am light, I am light, I am light. Oh, another thing, my weight has plummeted. This morning it was 187.5, I think. I said, what? Or 6, 187.6. I said, what? Just 2 days ago, I was at 191.5. So, sudden, you know, dramatic loss of like, was it 4 pounds or something? The diet is working. I just came up. I haven't been able to find a diet that works for years and years and years, and almost never. I came up with one a long time ago that worked. But this one, it just clicked. It just clicked. It's avocado and coleslaw. Put the coleslaw in the hole where you take the seed of the avocado out. And then when I take a scoop, mix the coleslaw with the avocado and you eat it, and then with a spoon, and then take more coleslaw and put it in the hole that's now left by the scoop, and then do another scoop, more coleslaw, another scoop, more coleslaw, another scoop, and that way, and just eat half an avocado. And then and don't eat anything after 6 o'clock. If I want to drink something, just drink grapefruit juice on the rocks, cold grapefruit juice. And that's it. What did I have for breakfast? Yogurt. Had some yogurt with walnuts. Had a small cup of yogurt with some walnuts. That's it. Don't feel very hungry. And I'm losing weight. I'm losing. It's just sudden. I mean, if you have the capacity to suddenly just dial it in and lose weight, you know, you're doing something really good. Because that's a toughie as you get older. Real difficult as you get older to lose weight. Yeah, someone just brought some cheesecake in from Cheesecake Factory, 3 big slices. And I said, nah, not eating it, not eating it. Nope, 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 nope. After 6, I'm not eating sweets. I had a grape or two. Yeah, but I guess that's a sweet. One grape, you know, that's a sweet now. It's just the willingness to do this, you know. Where's that coming from? The willingness to do all this stuff. Where's that coming from? How could this is a better version of myself. It's been there all along. It's just, it wasn't fruiting. It wasn't blooming. It's kind of like the flower's blooming. What's causing the flower to bloom? Well, just like kind of a nature, you can give like various substances to get flowers to bloom. You know, that fertilizer, various types of fertilizer, and poof, the flowers, you know, just bloom beautifully. You know, it's, this saying that I am light is like a psychological fertilizer that's causing the psyche to bloom. It's causing the psyche to bloom, and we have to bloom now. We have to bloom. The world has to see our best version. The world has to see our best version. I pulled into a gas station yesterday. I had Dion DiMucci playing on the radio, on the stereo, sorry, stereo. And I usually, you know, I stop, turn off the vehicle, get out, bump the gas, you know, and get back in. This time I said, hey, I'm singing great. I want to keep doing that. Why should I just stop when I'm going into a gas station? So I put the key, you know, so the on the battery positive, so that the, you know, air condition and the stereo would still work even though the engine's off. So the engine's off, but turn the engine off, then go forward to the, you know, the, so the accessories, whatever, is on. So the, and then open the door and pump the gas. The music was coming out the door, and I was just, and then I was just loving the music. And Donna, the prima donna, came on. And then I was kind of singing. I was singing it. You know, other people are pulling the gas station here and everything. And I just like kind of singing along and listening to this music, and nobody said anything. It's like, but I've never done that before. And I, this is like the 60s. This is the early 70s, 60s and early 70s, before things suddenly became really weird. People would be singing. People would be doing that. They'd be listening to their music. You know, everywhere in the parking lots. In parking lots, they'd be laughing. They'd be singing. You know, what? Why can't? When's the last time you saw anyone's just singing? You know, in a parking lot to the radio, to a song, or in a gas station, or anywhere. Anywhere. It's like, what the heck's going on in this world? Listen to this great music, and I was kind of dancing a little bit and feeling flexible, more flexible. I'm moving better because I'm feeling lighter now, and it's like I was doing great. The singing Donna, just like, wow, I'm putting some great vocal, you know, moves on that song. Then got back in, and drove and kept singing, and why not? Everybody is just, you know, they're scared. Everybody's scared. Maybe they'll get sued, you know. Or people are on edge. People are being very aggressive driving now. Very aggressive. So the mood of the world is extremely aggressive right now. So we need this light to be here that somehow diffuses the situation. This is what the great spiritual coaches in history have done. They come into the world at certain times to help to lessen the aggression in the world. That is a fact. And so we need as many of us as possible to say, I am light, and just be lighted, except I am light now. This is what I am. I am light, to lessen the aggression in the world. The aggression is, if not, the world is in for a world of hurt, a world of hurt. So we come to this four-way stop, and the traffic light is not functioning. The green, orange, red is not functioning. So it's just flashing red. Okay. So everybody knows what to do. You take your turns, right? Everybody stops. You see who's in the intersection first. Okay. You come up, you wait for them to go. Then it's your turn. So everybody's taking turns. Right? That's how it's supposed to work. So I come up to the intersection. I see people come up. Okay. You were there before. Okay. I got there. Now there's some other cars come up. And so I'm waiting for my turn. This one went. My turn. So I start to go, one car kind of like stops. And then two more cars, they start actually going into the intersection on me. And I said, what? You know, I kind of had to went around them like that. They just jumped me. That almost never happens. You know, everybody acts polite when you come to a four-way stop that's a flashing red. That's just common, you know, Curtis. You know what the drill is. There's no two ways about it. They just decide, we don't want, you know, we're just going to see if we can jump you. And if you and see if you back off. That's aggression. That's aggression. When this, I'm just gonna take advantage and see what happens. That kind of thing. This is what's going on. The people want to take advantage now. The aggression means people are decided that they're going to try and get the advantage. You know, no, to heck with ethics and morals and what's right and wrong and whatever. You know, we're just gonna see how much. You know, we gotta grab, seize the advantage in any way possible, kind of thing. And it's like, wow. So I this that's the second time. Just recently, it's happening more and more. Where cars tried to jump me. It happened just a couple last week. BMW tried to just jump me. I was clearly, I had stopped, came to a three-way stop, four-way stop. I had stopped. The BMW was coming down a hill. Clearly, it was my turn, and they tried to just jump me in front of me, just jump in front of me, and I went, and I went, got a big truck. I went, and they kind of, you know, like, didn't get, didn't win that time. You're not supposed to be trying to win when we're driving, you know. But they've taken their aggression to the to driving now, where they feel they need to win at this, like it's a battle or something. And you're supposed to be civil while driving. You're supposed to put all that competitiveness, that has no place on the road. No place on the road. You are mellow, you're relaxed, you're very polite, you're civil, you know, everybody takes their turn, everybody stays in their lane. This is not happening anymore. This is not happening. So when people, when the aggression is so strong, it overpowers people when they're driving, then you know things are out of control in the world. And a couple of years back, I went through a crosswalk. Car came, stopped. They saw me. I was walking across the crosswalk, and they just decided they were going to go. Like, you know, I want to win this one. I almost got run over. And I was like, what? And, you know, I was freaked me out. I said, what are you doing? It was some really expensive Audi. I mean, probably $100,000, $120,000. I mean, it was just, you know, one of those Audis. It was just, it was just like this 20-year-old girl driving the car, you know? And I get, she just decided, I'm so entitled in my Audi, I don't have to stop for people at the crosswalk if I don't want to, you know? And I was just blown away by that. Blown away. They just were gonna run me over. They're trying to just, you know, get out of my way. Get out of my way. I said, ah, sign of the times, sign of the times. Girls gone bad is the sign of the times. When you get that sort of mentality and you get these people with aggression and entitlement and they're driving a car like that, they feel they own the road. They own the road. They own you. They own you. They own everything. They own the road. It's their world. You know, you're just a slave in it, kind of thing. There's no respect there at all. I was like, wow. You know, you got to have respect. Respect, respect goes in every direction. It's not just Aretha Franklin saying, hey, you know, you got to respect us. Now, respect is for everyone. It goes in all directions when you're driving. Respect everybody equally when you're driving. And it's a great discipline. Here in California, how many years have I been driving? 45 years. No, 50 years. I've been driving for 50 years in California. I'm sure I put millions of miles. Driving is living here. This is what you have to do. You drive just so much. And so, you know how you have to respect everybody equally on the road. There's no prima donnas on the road. And it's so different now than it used to be. It's just night and day difference. Everybody wants to be a prima donna. You got all these cars just weaving, taking advantages in every which way, like it's a video game. So this is a psychosis that you don't do that when you're driving. It was, you know, you have to equal respect to everyone, and we all have to get along in order to drive. People are just throwing that out the window totally. Tons of people are just throwing it out the window, completely throwing it out the window, just to see, you know, what can I get away with here? So our culture has gone to hell. Our culture has gone to hell. When you see that showing up driving, that means our culture has gone to hell. We had this wonderful culture that people respected one another, and you know, on the road, you know, we're all equal on the road. Period. Period. And so that really gets drilled into you in California because you have to drive so much. There's this lack of trains, transit, everything. And so just it's a great meditation. It's a great training to see everyone equally, you know, and respect everyone equally here and not try to take advantage of people. But that's gone with the wind at this point. Gone with the wind. It's scary. So you need this extra gear in your life. You need an extra gear where you can just go back and okay, I am light. Don't get too upset. Say, I am light. I am light. And just keep elevating yourself. Got to keep elevating yourself. It's like getting in the elevator. You just hit top floor, you know, and just take the ride. Take the ride. Don't keep stopping every floor, Jacko. Just hit, I'm hitting the top floor button and just let's enjoy the ride in the elevator up to the top floor. Get the highest viewpoint possible right now. And it's probably the same way everywhere. The aggression is just intense, 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 intense. Yeah, so this does give it an extra gear. It's like the elevator starting to go up like this. You know, it's just starting to go like that. And the more you keep doing, just I am light, I am light, I am light, I am light, I am light. Refuse to stop and compromise. No compromise. It's just I am light. Period. No compromise at all. Going to the top floor. I was in the parking lot today, looked at this palm tree. The sun was getting low in the sky, and but the sun was still hitting the top of this palm tree and just glistening, beautifully glistening. I suddenly realized, why do I love palm trees? I sort of identify as the palm family. There's lotus. It's the same principle as the lotus, well, very similar. Because the early in the morning or late in the evening, where there's darkness and shadows everywhere else, look up, you see the palm tree, and it's still in the light. It's getting hit by the light, and it just looks beautiful in the morning or evening light, doesn't it? The dusk or dawn, the palm trees look so beautiful. I remember in the desert, get up at 5:30 in the morning to go golfing or to catch the sunrise or something, and the palm trees would get the light first, and they were just lit up, these beautiful lit up green. Everything else was still dark and dusky like that. Start dark and dawny, you know, but the palm trees were just beautiful. It's so beautiful to see that happen. So the symbolic is you be like the palm tree, like grow really high, and no matter the even though the sun may be low, the light may be, you know, not so much light, you're high enough so the light's still hitting the palm tree, the top of the palm tree, so you're still getting the light. It's beautiful, whereas everyone else is in shadows and darkness and shadow, you know. So that's why I've always loved palm trees. It's so hopeful. That's why lotuses are such a potent symbol in history, because the lotus grows up, you know, the roots are in the muddy, murky water, but the lotus is floating on top of the water and is getting all the light of the sun. It looks so beautiful, right? So it's symbolic that somehow it puts down roots. I don't know how lotus is able to do that. But they do, and float on the top of the water and put down roots into the mud. So the roots are in the mud, but the flowers in the light. You see, and it's so similar, like the palm tree. And something about palm leaves and such, it catches the light beautifully and reflects it beautifully. Whereas I look at the pine trees and the evergreens, they don't light up so nicely like the palm does. The palm is much brighter, seems to scintillate. I'm not a fan of like evergreen conifer types of trees, because the light doesn't, it kind of absorbs the light more, you know, rather the palm tree, it sends the light like a lighthouse sort of thing. I just love that look. That's why I love the desert, all the palm trees. It's so beautiful. It really is. Seeing these so many this like lighthouses in the sky all over the place. So I am light, 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 I am light. It's kind of like a psychological smoothie, like an energy smoothie, you know, taking a psychological smoothie. And it's like improving your psychological health. It's improving psychological health. Say, I am light. I am light, because you're telling yourself the truth. Telling yourself the truth, that it helps. That helps us psychologically to acknowledge the truth of our being, which is, I am light. 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 When I say that, I can feel it with it. I can feel something, you know, that this resonates strongly. You know, it's having an effect. It's like, again, psychological technique here that is elevating our life, is elevating our life. And so I'm just being a guinea pig here to see what happens, because I have confidence in the spiritual coaches. None of the practices they've ever given me have caused me much problem. They've always been helpful. So I trust them. The problem is, Sama's not going to give me this practice if it's going to cause me some severe trouble or anything like that. No. So it hasn't caused severe trouble at all. It's just, I'm feeling like a better version of myself is what's happening. And just to come up with a diet that you can actually follow and it's working, I mean, how cool is that? I'm feeling like, wow. You know, how far can I ride this, you know, this diet? I feel like I can do it. We'll see, but I feel like I'm bound to lose weight with this thing, with this diet, you know, bound to lose weight. Cabbage and avocado, coleslaw and avocado together, you know, it seems to fill you up and you don't have much cravings for food. And then the grapefruit juice, when you feel one little something, you know, take some grapefruit juice. Shrink the stomach. I mean, yeah, you know, just feel like you're really fit and trim and light and light on your feet. My feet were hurting so bad because it's too heavy. The ankles, the feet, everything was aching, and now they don't not as aching as bad, not aching as bad, right? It's like a renaissance, a rebirth, a rejuvenation, a resurrection, actually. That's going on here. So that's why I'm very, 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 very upbeat on what's going on. I don't want to pinch myself, you know, just like, is this a dream? You know, is this really happening? I just keep saying, I am light, 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 I am light. Wow. I am light, I am light, I am light, I am light. Wow. I am light, I am light, I am light. Wow. So I'm recording this. I got to get up real early tomorrow. And what time is this? 10:30 at night. After just working all day yesterday, just intense whirlwind yesterday, 5 days before that, so 7 days straight, you know, just straight every day working like just boom, 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 and still having time to go. Okay, it's late, but let's get this taping done. Still able to feel confident and competent to do that. So, yeah, I am light, I am light, I am light, I am light. It's kind of like we found the Holy Grail here. It was given to us, actually. We didn't find it. It was directly given to us. Interesting. That's different than, I didn't come across it myself. It was directly given to me without any question whatsoever by Padmasambhava. In appealing to him, I appealed to him. I said, Padmasambhava, I don't think I'm going to make it, to tell you the truth. And I desperately need your help. I'm turning to you because you are the big shot of big shots. You know, you are the big chief. And I'm coming to the big chief. I say, big chief, you know, I'm just a little Indian here, you know, but if you can help me, I would certainly appreciate the help, because I need it. Absolutely need it. It's do or die right now. And then that very evening, as I was laying in bed before I went to sleep, suddenly this voice, this presence and voice, he said, I am light. That's it. Super distinct, powerful, clear voice speaking to me. I am light. I was just like, wow. Prayers answered, you know, petition answered. The big chief came through. So, you know, it's not easy for just a little humble, nothing Indian to go to the chief of chiefs, the big chief of chiefs, and, you know, say, hey, chief of chiefs, you know, I could use some help. It's not easy. You got to swallow all your pride. You just wonder, How's the big chief going to receive you? You're so insignificant, you know? So, but Padmasambhava responds. That's, I know his characteristic is he responds to requests. He has promised us that anyone who calls upon his name, he will respond. Anyone, anywhere. He's made this huge promise to the world. And in my experience, he's kept that promise. Because the previous times I've called up on him a little bit, you know, the response is just amazing. The Lotus Family response is just amazing. So quick, so powerful, so helpful. But this time it was the big one. It was do or die. I said, this chip's on the table here. And he came through in a magnificent way, Padmasambhava said, just saying, I am light. Magnificent way. So, just this little humble, insignificant person that doesn't really, the world could care less about me. The world could absolutely care less about me. It sees no value in me. But Padmasambhava sees some value. So he says, just say this, just say, I am light. Just do that. Just do that. That's it. Just do it. And see what happens. See what happens. I say, yeah. Okay. Let's do it. Let's see what happens. I am light. 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 Wow. Someone came up in the supermarket, blindsided me, says, hey, how you doing? And I just turned around and said, oh, hello, so-and-so. Like that. The name just was right there, the recognition, boom, boom, boom. Usually before I would like be kind of like startled and unnerved and stuff. This time I just pirouetted and said, oh, hi, how's it going? Nice to see you. I was like, yeah, blah, 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 blah. And then, okay, they said, okay, so see you. And I said, yeah, like that. It's like socialization is better. Socialization is better. I was at the cashier today in a market, and the cashier sort of have a history a little bit in terms of the person is kind of abrasive and not the best company to be around. And so I just hope this goes well. So I said, I am light. I am light. And they did make a remark like, you can take your card out now. It's just an abrasive person. I was like, okay. Kept saying, I am light. And then suddenly I looked up, and there was a different cashier there. Really nice to me. Really pleasant and nice to me as they completed the trend. Somehow they had switched. I get this first one had some like gone on break or something. This other one took over for them. I was like, I saw, I said, wow. So I went from kind of this attitude, which is this person has an attitude, known it for a long time, has an attitude, abrasive. They suddenly disappeared, and this other one came in who had a really, really genuinely nice attitude towards me. I was like, what? And the bagger, really nice attitude towards me too. And just like, oh, wow. You see? I mean, like, that just happened just this evening. So you notice that and you say, holy cow. That's nice. That's really, really nice. That's happening. So this is like, I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light. Somehow it brings better situations into your life. And I'm not worried about how it does it. I don't care how it does it. I'm just going to keep saying it. I don't care how it does it. It's just, I am light. I am light. I am light. My job is just to say this. I am light. Wow. I am light. Wow. I'll let the light do the rest. Okay. I'm just going to be saying this. And you can say it too. There's nobody that's saying it. Nobody can stop you from doing it. Nobody can stop you from doing it. The job box is the lock is like jammed. I've been trying to get it open and I couldn't get it open. It's jammed. So I went back a couple of days ago, and I had some tools. I said, I'm gonna need these tools. I'm gonna fight with this thing. Put the key in, turned it, boom, opened right up. I was like, what? How'd that happen? How did that happen? That hasn't happened before with these, when these locks get jammed. Boy, you have to fight them. Get a chisel, you get a screwdriver and a hammer and stuff. And I just turned the key and the thing just opened right up like it was like just completely obedient, just be nice to me. So that, I noticed and I said, how did that happen? So I'm having all sorts of situations like this where stuff just starts working. the stove. Just stuff. Just now, it's working. The job box lock is just working now. It's just nice to me. The light. It's the light. It's the light. It's the light. That's why these great spiritual coaches, they have so much light. Everything just goes smoothly around them, and just problems just dissolve, just dissolve, just dissolve. It's true. I know, studying saints, great spiritual coaches, I know this is what happens with them, because they got so much something. But it's the light. It's the light. Somehow the light takes care of kicks care of you. You know, just if you so I am light, I am light, I am light, I am light, I am light. Because I realize without massive help, we're doomed here. I certainly am. Without massive help, I'm doomed. I can see the future. That there's so much bad possibilities stacking up, and so I just say, hey, let the light take care of it. Let's let the light take care of it, my life. I put my hand, life in the hands of the light, because I am light. Literally, I am light. That's what I am. I am light. I identify as light. That's not on the menu. You'll be like, that's not on the woke menu. You know, it's, well, it is now. It is now. We're just putting it there. Padmasambhava put it there. There's nobody pulling rank on Padmasambhava, I'll tell you that. There is nobody in this world pulling rank on Padmasambhava, period. So Padmasambhava puts that there. This is Padmasambhava's wokeness, okay? So we're hearing the wokeness from Madison Avenue and the tech people and everybody else that's doing their entitlement thing. Okay, fine. But now Padmasambhava is giving his version of wokeness to us, and that is, I am light. I am light, I am light, I am light. Wow. That's Padmasambhava's wokeness. I'll say, I'll take that wokeness, yeah. That's my wokeness. That's my wokeness. So we got wokeness. Sure, we're woke too. Join the party. But we've got our wokeness from Padmasambhava, from the Lotus family. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. Just do that. I means tapping the wow means tapping the brakes. I am light, I am light, I am light. Tap the brakes. Wow. See, I am light, I am light, I am light. Tap the brakes. Wow. Just like that. Just like that. Everybody's gonna go woke one way or the other in this world, I'll tell you that. And those other folks, what they're doing, okay, they're headed for a world of hurt, a world of hurt, a world of hurt, and they're calling that woke, because that's supposed to convince the prime creator to euthanize itself, see? So they're doing a heck of a job working on that angle, except we know that's a completely useless and needless angle, because the prime creator is not incapacitated, not disabled, is flawlessly functioning. There's no reason whatsoever to try and get rid of the prime creator. Okay, we know that for sure. And so we don't have to go in that direction at all. So we have a woke direction from Padmasambhava, which is to say, I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. The only fear is that if I'm not going to do it enough, you know, it's like I want to be able to do it like constant, you know, all the time, just nonstop, because we need the light in the world right now. We need the light grounded in the world to lessen the aggression in people. It's been built up on purpose, and I've seen the whole thing, how they built it all up. So very aware of what's happening, and it's designed to produce hyper aggression. These times, hyper aggression. You know, amphetamines is almost not quite 100 years, but 90 years. Well, 80 years of amphetamines, let's say 80 years, a little bit more than 80 years. The Beatles. I talked about the Beatles before and how the mood completely changed in the world when the Beatles came along, January of 1964. And, you know, essentially, the Beatles were like the Everly Brothers on amphetamines is what their Beatles actually were. They idolized the Everly Brothers. They were trying to sound like the Everly Brothers. They did sound like the Everly Brothers. That they didn't invent what they did. They were taking it from the Everly Brothers. But they were the Everly Brothers on amphetamines. That's the difference. That's the difference. Because they were heavily, heavily hooked on amphetamines, some more than others. Certainly Lennon was extremely hooked on amphetamines. And the others to more or less extent, you know, they went along with it and didn't, not to the extent that Lennon did, but it permeated the band. It permeated the band. And so they were the Everly Brothers on amphetamines, what the Beatles actually were. Please, please me, oh yeah, like I please you. Last night I said these words to my girl. Boom, 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 boom. I know you never even try, girl. Boom, 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 boom. Come on, 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 come on. Please, please me, oh yeah, like I please you. I don't wanna stay nothing ever but a thing. Oh yeah, why do you leave me blue? Last night I said these words to my girl. That's Everly Brothers on amphetamines right there. Absolutely it is. That is the Everly Brothers on amphetamines. Speed it up, jazzed up, hyped up, pumped up. Everly Brothers on amphetamines. That's the Beatles. Now, yeah, it's kind of like, you know, kind of mind-blowing, you know, that the intensity of it, like, Please Please Me, that the intensity of that song compared to the music that came before is just like, is like nothing you ever heard before. That's because it's, they were on drugs. Amphetamines. Hamburg, the Beatles became the Beatles in Hamburg, Germany. And Hamburg, Germany is notorious throughout history as one of the most debauched places in the world. It's a port city. It's one of the biggest ports in Europe, in the world, Hamburg. And the sailors come in from all over the world, and they come into town, and they want to party, 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 party. So it's a super party place, Hamburg. It's a raunchy, debauched place, Hamburg. And the Beatles were in the tavern, the cavern, you know, below the street level. And it was a raunchy, rowdy, debauched audience. And this is, you know, and they were trying to, you know, they're playing these people. This is how they became the Beatles. And they discovered the tons of drugs flowing in Hamburg, that is for sure. And they discovered amphetamines. They realized that they could just play, you know, hours at a time, and the people loved it. They loved it, and they play three sets a day. They could do that, you know. They were sleeping in some horrible quarters. It was just their life, the food and the sleep was horrible, but they just kept gobbling these amphetamines, and they just get out there and mock show, you know, mock show, mock show, and they just, the people, like I said, these guys are crazy. They perfected this kind of intense craziness, really. And then of course the producers, George Martin and Brian Epstein, their manager, and Abbey Road Studio and all of that, and was it EMI that was producing them, you know, all the engineers, they, you know, crafted it and popped it up so it would be acceptable to teen audiences. But teen audiences at that time, they were really getting jazzed up as well. They were getting into their mom's medicine cabinet is what they were doing. Like, what are these pills? Like, mom takes these pills every day. Let me try one of these. Like, kaboom, you know, tons and tons and tons of upper middle class women had amphetamines in their medicine cabinet. It was diet pills and depression, mild depression pills. And, you know, the thing is, back in the 50s and 60s, you have to realize most people don't understand this at all, but we're telling it here. At that time, amphetamines were seen as the greatest miracle that science has ever come up with. It was the miracle drug, and science was lauded for it. And They said, "My God, this thing cures mild depression. It cures lethargy and laziness. It's a perfect weight loss pill. It does all of the stuff. It makes you as much more efficient and bright and a functional citizen." It was the miracle drug, amphetamines. Absolutely, it was. And people just said, "Wow, science really is solving our problems." They just thought it was the greatest thing ever. Now, the Wehrmacht and the Nazis realized in battle that you get amphetamine psychosis. But that, you know, was hushed up. Culture hushed it up. John Kennedy was on, and his whole circle, Camelot, was on amphetamines. He was on a lot of stuff, but most people around his orbit was on amphetamines. Most of the entertainers were on it. A lot of entertainers, Elvis, was on amphetamines. But it had no negative connotations at all. Just the opposite. It was like you were advanced and with it, and you were following science by taking amphetamines because you were a better person for it. You were smarter, you were quicker, you were more vivacious, you were thinner, you know, you had more energy, you were more positive. You see, if we felt that it cured our psychological problems and made us much better versions of ourselves back in the 50s and 60s. So the young people growing up, I remember very well, my parents didn't take any medicines at all. We didn't have any medicines in the house. We may have had baby aspirin, but that's it. Sort of believe in Christian Science, so to speak. And so we had no medicines in our medicine cabinet. But the people I knew, you know, their parents were doctors, lawyers, accountants, all sorts of professional people. Their parents had medicine cabinets with a lot of drugs in their medicine cabinets, and they would go into those medicine cabinets. It was the thing to do in junior high school, even elementary school, junior high school. What did you get from the medicine cabinet? You know, they'd get these pills. I never took any pills, never had amphetamines, nothing. Because we were raised strictly, you never take pills. You never take pills, period. But my friends, the people I know, and just the overall, you know, class, the people of my generation, they were heavily into pills and taking their parents' pills without their parents knowing about it. And you're talking about pharmaceutical grade amphetamines, was these diet pills and antidepressant, little, you know, mood booster pills. This stuff was basically the same stuff they're taking. Adderall and, you know, what are they taking? You know, Adderall and the various, you know, amphetamines they're taking. It was the same. It was pharmaceutical, high, powerful amphetamines, and the kids were gobbling these. They were taking them. They did go to school. After school, at parties, they were using all this stuff. They were drinking and using these amphetamines. And so the Beatles came along, and they're like, we understand this energy. We understand this energy, especially the girls. The girls are under their mother's medicine cabinets. Big time, big time, big time, big time. That's why they went so crazy at parties and dances. They just went crazy. And the Beatles came along and they said, "Here's our saviors. They understand us. They know the mood that we're in." They connected. It was a drug connection with the Beatles, with these adolescent girls. These adolescent girls were not these ingenues. No, these adolescent girls were clever and sneaky, and they were sneaking the drugs from their parents' medicine cabinets. No question about it. I can absolutely testify this is the truth. They told me for sure. This was like they're bragging about it. And so then the Beatles came with their amphetamine-fueled music, connected with these young girls, these girls and teenage girls, and kaboom, they went absolutely crazy, idolized them, still do idolize them, total idolatry. It was the end thing. Suddenly, they knew better than anybody else. It's an amphetamine psychosis, as you think you're onto something that nobody, you know, you're now woke. You're onto something extraordinary. Okay, but there was drugs that they were on to, actually. And the rest is history, very negative history, actually, very negative. Amphetamines cause extreme problems, psychosis in culture and society. Extreme, we don't know how bad it is, but we're going to find out pretty soon. I've been told the agencies of grace have had me focus on this issue. They're telling me this is an extremely important issue, actually. this, what's fueling the world is drugs and the drug culture, and feeling that, you know, you're somehow, you know, more woke because you're taking amphetamines and the connecting with drug music and making you feel like, oh, we know something the other people don't know, the squares, you know, they don't know this stuff. We're onto something special. We got something really special going on. Now you got aggression going on is what you got. Special kind of aggression going on. That's what happened. So the culmination of this is going to culminate at some point where it could be terrible in the world. The aggression has built up through culture more and more and more and more and more. So we're going to, you know, deflate the aggression of the world by bringing in the light. Yes, I call it, you know, natural amphetamines, so to speak. Natural amphetamines. It doesn't lead to aggressiveness. It leads to benevolence. It leads to kindness, benevolence, and just this wonderful ethereal vibe, you might say, of the light. I am light. I am light. I am light. Wow. I am light, I am light, I am light. Wow. So here you get real history here. You get real history here. The stuff that they're teaching kids these days is such a lie. It's just like nonstop lies is what they're hearing. Nonstop lies. The kid, I'm reading some of the comments about the, you know, younger people online. I said, what in the world are they teaching these kids? An alternative reality. Their history is so bad, it's just unbelievable. Unbelievable how wrong they've got it, how twisted they've got it. Because they don't know, they weren't there. So they just believe the teachers. The teachers say, this is what happened back then. No. So the teachers are just teaching the kids lie after lie after lie. It's a culture of lies. I always say, the woke culture is a culture of lies. It's a culture of lies. And that's why they think they're so woke, because they're like, hey, we can just make up anything we want to make up, and it's true. Yeah. That's so creative, you know. That's not being pragmatic. That is not being pragmatic. That's not how you get to where you want to get to. So to get to where you want to get to, just say, I am light. Okay, that's being super pragmatic. Being pragmatic means to listen to the big chiefs, the really big chiefs. Okay. Padmasambhava is one of those. And when Padmasambhava says, I am light, and gives that to us, that's being super pragmatic. And then just do it. Don't ask why. Don't question. I never questioned. I just said, okay, let's get with this. Let's get with this. Yeah, that's it. You don't question it. He didn't give me a chance to question it. He said, I just realized this is the transmission. This is what we're given. Do it. Do it. That's super pragmatism. I am light. I am light. I am light. I am light. And just watch your life bloom. Just watch your life bloom. Interesting. I went to this place, this restaurant, where it had all these flowers, incredible, like tropical flowers blooming in the Bay Area here. It's like unbelievable. These huge hibiscus flowers, these gorgeous golden hibiscus flowers. And lantana blooming like crazy. I said, what in the world, you know, how do they manage that? Is this, you can't grow hibiscus like this in the Bay Area. I've tried, you know, I don't know how they do it, you know, but it was there. And I drove around the whole area and walked around. Just saw all these gorgeous flowers everywhere. Interesting, right? That's very interesting. That was on the 30th of September, and I had received the transmission from Padmasambhava on the 26th of September, and I was already doing the practicing. And so I was taken to this like Eden-like place, beautiful Eden-like place with gorgeous lagoons and bougainvillea, just massive bougainvillea growing all over in these lagoons. It was just beautiful. Yeah, that was like on the, you know, starting to practice, I am light, I am light, I am light. Yeah. So this is really interesting, you know, really interesting. It's giving an idea of like blooming. You can bloom even in a place where you shouldn't be blooming, hibiscus.